Hello, everybody. Is this working? You hear me there in the back? Thank you. I'm Sean Carroll. I am co-founder, along with Janine Ismail, of the Natural Philosophy Forum here at Johns Hopkins. You may remember natural philosophy as what we used to call science back in the day of Isaac Newton and Galileo and those folks, when it was part of philosophy, and we're bringing it back together. We're making sure that there is a place here at Hopkins and the world for scientists and philosophers to work together, to talk together, to share ideas about understanding the fundamental nature of reality. And one of the first things that Janine and I thought to do was to start an annual lecture series. One of Janine's first comments was, no, it's the distinguished annual lecture series. So it is. And we had needed, therefore, a distinguished lecturer, and we could not have done better than to get Daniel Dennett, who will be the first ever Johns Hopkins Natural Philosophy Forum Distinguished Annual Lecturer. Given that you're here, you probably don't need to be told that much about Dan Dennett. If you're of my age and of a certain sort of mathy science bent, your first introduction to him was that you are a big fan of Gödel, Escher, Bach when you were a teenager. The book by Douglas Hofstadter, wonderful book about Gödel's theorem and music and art and things like that. And you became a kind of a fanboy for Douglas Hofstadter and like looked up his next books. And the next book to come out was a co-edited volume called The Mind's Eye with this guy named Daniel Dennett. I thought it was so sweet that Douglas Hofstadter would let this young, striving philosopher help him out with his essay collection. And then you just kept seeing Dan Dennett's name over and over again. Turns out he has something to say about consciousness, about free will, about naturalism, about artificial intelligence and computers, about evolutionary biology. And then you realize that this is just the public-facing stuff, and he's done very important things in the technical philosophy literature about the intentional stance and real patterns. And finally, you discover that not only has he been a wonderful philosopher, an absolute paradigm of engaging with science very deeply and very carefully, but he's also wonderful to listen to and to read. He is the author of many books. I'm not going to tell you all of their titles, but you should buy all of them, right? And you're going to hear in a second his remarkable ability to take these really deep, important ideas and make them sparkle and come to life and make you think about them. And we're just so excited about natural philosophy here at Hopkins. It's a great place for it, and we couldn't think of a better way to start off the whole thing. So please give a warm welcome to Daniel Dennett.
Thank you, Sean, and thank you, Janine, for this great honor to be the first of these. I've been looking forward to this day ever since you invited me. And I'm so glad to be back at Hopkins, where I've had some wonderful adventures of learning things over the years. So here's my talk: how, when, and why can we trust our brains? Let's see if this works. Yes. So what are we doing here? That is, why are you here and why am I here? Why might you want to listen to me? Well, you might learn something, or you might teach me something. What I'm going to do today is I'm going to talk about current problems not yet solved. I want to leave you with an agenda of things to work on. These are the things I'm thinking about and working on. So this, as often as philosophers, we're better at the questions than the answers. So I'm going to try to motivate some questions today. I'll try to answer a few as well. And I'm going to start off with a quote that by a philosopher. This never caught on, and I think it's partly due to the name of it. But I want to read through this little passage by an old friend of mine. I haven't seen him for many years, Roger Wertheimer. And he calls it the factunorm principle, which I think is a terrible name. But let's just walk through it. What and how we do think is evidence for the principles of rationality. What and how we ought to think. This itself is a methodological principle of rationality. Call it the factu norm principle. We are implicitly accepting the factu norm. We are implicitly accepting the factu norm principle whenever we try to determine what or how we ought to think. For we must, in that very attempt, think. And unless we can think that what and how we do think there is correct, and thus is evidence for what and how we ought to think, we cannot determine what or how we ought to think. So, if we think we can make any progress at all on how we ought to think, it must be because we think we already know how we ought to think, because otherwise we wouldn't be wasting our time doing this. Now, this isn't a paradox, but it's curiously convoluted fact, and I want to use it as a springboard to talk about some of the implications of this fact. Now, in one sense, this is nothing new. This is Otto Neurath's ship. Quine leads off his book Word and Object with this in German. I'm not going to give it to you in German. I'm going to give you an English translation. We're like sailors who on the open sea must reconstruct their ship, but are never able to dismantle it in dry dock. The important thing to remember about Otto Neurath's ship is that this is possible. Sailors do it, have been doing it for thousands of years. You can rebuild your ship while you're afloat on it without going into dry dock. Of course, you might say, well, we'll have to bootstrap. Bootstrap is an interesting word, because originally it's picking yourself up by your own bootstraps. That is impossible. You can't pick yourself up by your own bootstraps. But computer scientists thought that that was a fine word to discuss, to name the opening message to get your computer up and running, to bootstrap your computer. That's what a boot is, when you reboot your computer. So they're sort of making a joke. They're saying, how do you get a computer up and running? Well, you bootstrap it. But it's picking itself up by its own bootstraps. Well, yeah, it's possible. Worth remembering. So what we have to do, though, if we're going to be Otto Neurath sailors, is we have to abandon the goal of a foolproof path to truth. What can we say, then, using our best thinking, about how, when, and why we can trust our brains? Now, for the philosophers present, I want to provide an ism scorecard. Some philosophers love isms. I don't. But I bow to the demand sometimes. So foundationalism. Have I not just thumbed my nose at foundationalism? Yes. Foundationalism, boo. Just in case anybody had any doubts about that. Some of you may be a fan of Emo Phillips. I am, very funny guy. He once said, I used to think the brain was the most fascinating part of the body. Then I thought, look who's telling me that. Now, his brain is telling him that. He's not his brain. There's his brain, and then there's him, and they're two different ones, and the brain is telling him this. Who's this him that is being instructed by his brain? That's the question that is at the heart of what I want to talk about today. So let's go back to my talk title, which is How, When, and Why Can We Trust Our Brains? And I have a little quiz for you. And I think what I will ask you to do is to just yell out your answer to the quiz. What's the most important word in my title?
Trust.
We is the most important word in the title. And I'll sell, if you want to know why, that's what I'm going to tell you. Who is this we that wonders whether we trust our brains? That's the question. And it raises the first person point of view. Somehow there's a first person point of view that each of us has. But I'm going to suggest a slight variation on this for today, because I don't want to talk about the first person point of view. I want to talk about the first person plural point of view. What can we, working together, know? That's, I think, a very important step that a lot of people haven't seen the value of making. And so I'm going to try to make it vivid for you today. And I'm going to start with a little intuition pump that I concocted many years ago, 1978, in fact. And I sort of dropped it, and I sort of wish I hadn't. And I'm going to give it a rebirth here on this occasion. And this is the intuition pump of the windowless control room. You wake up in a windowless control room, the walls covered with lights and buttons. A note on the table tells you that you are imprisoned in the control room of a giant robot, and your life now depends on your guiding the giant vessel safely through life. To your dismay, however, you see that none of the lights or buttons are labeled. You can't tell whether the insistently flashing light on the upper left corner is warning danger, signaling a full belly, informing you of the location of the sun, or requesting grease for a heel bearing. You don't know whether when you push a button and the light goes out, you've scratched an itch, occluded your view of something, or destroyed an attacker. Well, if that's all you're given to go on, your task is impossible, quite clearly. If you succeeded in guiding your robot through the day, it would be sheer luck. Yet in one sense, all the information you need is conveyed to you. The flashing lights can represent the products of perceptual analysis machinery as sophisticated as you wish. And similarly, the output switches can be supposed to initiate devious actions guided by hierarchical subroutine systems informed by multi-layer feedback. In other words, the entire array of systems devised by cognitive scientists could be built into the robot so that it conveyed to its control center highly mediated and refined and relevant information. And yet, though in one sense the information would be there, in another, more important sense, it wouldn't be. Jimmy Gibson famously said, "The information is in the light." Yeah, there's a sense in which that's right. But the same information falls on the tree and on the squirrel. But the tree makes scant use of it. It's not that trees can't make use of information falling, and they can. There are recent discoveries that show that trees can respond to the polarity of the light landing on them to know, in effect, that green is growing up around them. They better put more energy into growing taller so that they can get more of the sunlight. It's an adaptive response. So trees are not completely unable to use information landing on their surfaces. They can. But compared to the squirrel can do a lot more. So this immediately suggests, of course, okay, what we need to put in that control room is a squirrel, or better yet, a smart person. But of course, the smart person, if there's no labels and no images and no pictures, is going to be stuck. And so you may think, well, if only there were labels on those buttons. Well, for that, you'd need a user that could read the labels. If only there were pictures, not flashing lights. Well, then you'd need an agent in the control room that can see and that knows what things look like. If only there were a window, I could go and open the window and look out and see what went with what, compare notes. These ideas, and humor me, how many of you thought of at least one of those when you thought about this problem? Any of you? Yeah, right, this most natural thing in the world. So yeah, yeah, well, you gotta have a window there, then that'll get us out of this bind. But these ideas all illustrate a fundamental but highly seductive mistake. Your brain is in this predicament. It's locked in the dark inside your skull, with no windows to look out of, no eyes to see. Right? How on earth is it able to do its good work? And at this point, we face a great choice point, and it's a choice between magic and science. Imagining such a control center just postpones the explanation by postulating a homunculus, a knowing, comprehending agent, like the squirrel, a perpetual motion machine of sorts. I got to tell a little story that John McCarthy, the person who coined the term artificial intelligence, once told me. Plutocrat decides to build a perpetual motion machine. And out in the desert, he has this great big hangar and trucks pulling up with machinery all day. And one day he invites his friend over to see the perpetual motion machine. And he walks inside and there are these giant wheels and springs and valves and everything. And the only thing is, it's not moving. And his friend says, but it's not moving. And the man says, yeah, I need a little thing over in the corner here that goes like this. You can't solve these problems by having a little thing in the corner that goes like this. You can't solve the problem by putting a homunculus in there. That's just a fantasy. And yet, many philosophers and some scientists insist on taking this image seriously. One thing I think is now clear to most workers in the field, there could be what I call a Cartesian theater, but there isn't. Now, when I wrote Consciousness Explained, I went hammer and tongs against the idea of a Cartesian theater. And a lot of people were puzzled, but what was I saying? Was I saying that it was impossible? That it was a contradiction in terms, or was it an empirical fact? So I want to make that clear. I'm going to do that with a little film clip. Hope it works. Let's see if it works. Yes, it does. That's it, folks, the Cartesian theater, right there. The little homunculus in there, he's got the screens, all the buttons to push. All right. Gonna go on to the next slide. So, I submit, there's no logical incoherence in that scene. And if we were ever to go to the planet of the giant people, maybe the right way to go would be to build a giant robot with a human being sitting in the control rooms. To pass for one of the giants. That's perfectly coherent. So we know, in principle, there could be a Cartesian theory, just that there isn't. And then there's the conceptual point, which is, if there is a Cartesian theater, then we have to, we simply got to postpone our analysis and look at what's going on inside the brain of the homunculus. And if there's a Cartesian theater, and we'll have to do that again. And in the end, at some point, you have to get rid of, you have to dismantle the Cartesian theater altogether and replace it with some machinery, not a perpetual motion machine, some machinery that can actually do the work that the imagined homunculus was going to do. And it turns out on our planet, there's no Cartesian theater in us. So at the very first opportunity, we have to dismantle it and get rid of it. All the work done by the imagined homunculus in the Cartesian theater must be distributed around to lesser agencies in the brain. Great. How? That, to me, is the most interesting question that I'm working on and that others are working on, and I think we can make some progress on it, but it's not easy. I've also called this the hard question, and then what happens? All right, you get all of this information up to the brain, and then what happens? How do you get it to do what we can do? That's the scientific question, which we have to answer, and introspection doesn't help. Introspection just seems magical. This is the hard question we're tackling these days. Okay, now, what are philosophers good for? I often wonder. Other people often wonder. It's one of the occupational hazards of being a philosopher. It's that a lot of people don't take us very seriously and don't wonder if we're good for anything. Well, we're good for lots of things, actually. But I'm just going to mention two. One is reminding us of obvious truths that escape our notice in the thick of battle. That's something that sometimes philosophers can do. And another thing they can do, and that's what I'm really going to focus on, is bravely assert and defend falsehoods. There's a famous line attributed to Wolfgang Pauli. Dismissing another physicist's theory is not even wrong. And I'm going to talk about philosophers who are, that's not their problem. They are wrong, but wrong in vivid and interesting ways that help us focus our attention. I'm going to give you a few examples. This is an example of a bit of advice I've been, I'm retired as of January, but I've been giving my students for years, and that is, blurt it out, then you have something to fix. When you can't think of what to do next, just blurt out whatever's on your mind. Maybe you'll be lucky, or at least you'll have something that you can then reconsider and fix. So here are some heroic philosophers. John Searle, 1980. Remember, in these discussions, always insist on the first-person point of view. No, that is a recipe for confusion and failure of imagination. You're not going to solve these problems if you insist on the first-person point of view. He goes on to explain a bit. He says the first step in the operationalist sleight of hand occurs when we try to figure out how we would know what it would be like for others. Well, no. He may call it operationalist sleight of hand, but I call it the honest road to research. Here's another historic, heroic philosopher, Jerry Fodor, and I love this. My dear late friend Jerry Fodor once said, if there's a community of computers living in my head, there'd also better be somebody who's in charge, and by God, it had better be me. As a heartfelt, zingy expression of basically Cartesian mysticism, this is hard to beat. But he said it, and he meant it with all his heart and soul. Thank you, Jerry. (Clears throat) I once said, if I can see farther than the others, it's because I've been jumping on Jerry. He's a human trampoline. What would I do without these philosophers that make these vivid mistakes? Another good one is Burton Voorhees. Daniel Dennett is the devil. There is no inner witness, no central recognizer of meaning, and no self other than an abstract center of narrative gravity, which is itself nothing but a convenient fiction. For Dennett, it is not the case of the emperor having no clothes, it's rather that the clothes have no emperor. Exactly. And if you don't realize that, you're never going to have a theory of consciousness, because you've still got a conscious emperor in there that you haven't begun to analyze. Thank you, Burton Voorhees. I've got another one. These authors are fascinating because they try to explain away their own conscious experience, their own qualia. As the philosopher John Searle puts it, how could an intelligent person paint themselves into such a corner? They certainly give it a good try, but as well as being crazy, it's also, of course, dehumanizing. They end up saying we're all some kind of deluded zombie or machine. I give you these quotations because you see there's real passion involved. This is a moral issue for many people. They can't get their head around the idea that a theory that doesn't honor what they think of as sacred truths can't be right. And I'm saying, no, they're all just wrong. I got one more, Galen Strawson. He's my most recent and most adamant objector on what he calls the denial. He has called it the silliest claim ever made. Thank you, Galen. I accept the honor. This is the great silliness. We must hope that it doesn't spread outside the academy or convince some future information technologist or roboticist who has great power over our lives. He goes on, one of the strangest things the deniers say is that although it seems that there is conscious experience, there isn't really any conscious experience. The seeming is, in fact, an illusion. The trouble with this is that any such illusion is already and necessarily an actual instance of the thing said to be an illusion. Now, this is a mistake that he's making. That's my view, is, and the view of us other denialists, is not that consciousness doesn't exist, but it isn't what you think it is. The illusion is that some of the features of our conscious experience are not what they seem naively to be. That's all. So this presumed reductio is just missing the point. A little bit more. This is this is the foreword to Galen's new book, where he gives us a little history. Analytic philosophy as a whole, large entity, was unmoved by the denial. Block, Chomsky, Jackson, Lockwood, McGinn, Nagel, Nozick, Kripke, Parfit, Searle, P.F. Strawson, Williams, and a host of others, including all moral philosophers, never took the denial seriously. No more did Fodor, though he chose not to write about it. Well, we've already seen he's wrong about Fodor. Fodor did weigh in on this. And by the way, Jackson, Nozick, and Parfit more or less agree with me. It didn't go into it at great length, so Galen is reaching with his list of those who have not taken me seriously, or us seriously. He goes on, the denial has protean energy. It excites and recruits by startling. It has mystical allure, an odor of revolution. It moves under cover of the darkness. It spreads by looking-glassing the meanings of key terms. To looking-glass a term is to define it in such a way that whatever the term then means excludes what it actually means. So look out for those denialists. And he goes on and says, the denial persists, if only as a local but still highly visible and rather smug fashion. I thought about that. I thought, well, hey, I am rather smug about it, aren't I? Here I am chortling about it here, presenting it to you. I am rather smug about it. Yeah. I just wish he'd spell my first name right. Some scientists make the same mistake. It's not just philosophers. Here's Christoph Koch. Many modern analytic philosophers of mind, most prominently perhaps Daniel Dennett of Tufts University, find the existence of consciousness such an intolerable affront to what they believe should be a meaningless universe of matter and the void that they declare it to be an illusion. That is, they either deny that qualia exist or argue that they can never be meaningfully studied by science. If that assertion was true, this essay would be very short. I'm not going to bother pointing out the mistakes in Koch's assertion here, because I'm going to go on to somebody else whom I take a little more seriously, actually, and that is David Deutsch. Fine computer scientist, physicist. And he writes, qualia are neither describable, qualia, the so-called properties of conscious experience, are neither describable nor predictable. A unique property that should make them deeply problematic to anyone with a scientific worldview, though in the main it seems to be mainly philosophers who worry about it. I consider this exciting evidence that there is a fundamental discovery to be made which will integrate things like qualia with other knowledge. Daniel Dennett draws the opposite conclusion, namely that qualia do not exist. I say, consciousness exists, but qualia don't. It's just the idea that qualia are properties of conscious states, that's the mistake. For a very simple reason, vision isn't television. Back to the initial thought experiment. There's no screen in the control room with properties identified and enjoyed by an inner homunculus. There's no second transduction. What do I mean by that? Photons land on the eye, pressure waves land in the ear, these get transduced into spike chains. Trains in neurons, and it's spike trains all the way. There's no transduction into another medium where the consciousness happens, where the little band in the brain strikes up the music, where the colors are displayed on the screen. That's where people are making the mistake. They are reproducing the properties that they're thinking that vision is like television. Television doesn't send little blobs of color through the air, it sends information electromagnetic radiation, and then that gets transformed into color on a screen if you're gonna watch a television set. But that second transduction just doesn't happen in the brain. Now, I've been talking about other people's mistakes, now I want to talk about my mistake. And my big mistake I made way back in 1969, this is what I said. The little man in the brain, Ryle's ghost in the machine, is a notorious non-solution to the problems of mind, though it is not entirely out of the question that the brain writing analogy will have some useful application. It does appear merely to replace the little man in the brain with a committee. I want to point out something about this, which is also a feature of some of the other quotes I've given you. I was lured by a wisecrack. This is sort of punchy, sort of fun, ha ha. And that's why I made a big mistake, saying they're replacing the little man with a committee. this is like fodder, and by God, it better be me. It's using an emotional zing instead of a careful argument. So that was a mistake I made in content and consciousness, but I did correct it. Replacing the little man with a committee is actually the key. It's a good move to make. As I said in brainstorms, homunculi are bogeymen only if they duplicate entire the talents they're rung in to explain. If you can get a team, a committee of relatively ignorant, narrow-minded, blind homunculi to produce the intelligent behavior of the whole, this is progress. So one mistake was thinking that replacing the little man in a committee was not progress. It is progress. That's what everybody is working on, whose work I take seriously. Now, one way or another, they're working on this. Bill Lycan once named this homuncular functionalism. So if you want to know the name for the view, that's it. But there's another mistake I made, which is replacing the big thinker by a committee is also the key. Here's what my friend and colleague Keith Frankish posted just a few days ago on Twitter. Descartes' project in the Meditations assumes epistemic individualism. His question was what he, individually, could be sure of. What if he'd started by asking what we, collectively, can be sure of? Bingo, exactly right. We want to think about collective knowledge, collective understanding, if we want to make sense of this. Descartes had to ring in God to guarantee his clear and distinct ideas. And he thought he could get this with a proof for the existence of God, and it gave him sort of top-down security. He had a gilt-edged, top-down, God-guaranteed God guarantee for the truth of his clear and distinct ideas. Desperate and false. Bottom up, there's no guarantee of certainty. But there is a path to trust your life on it, reliability. We all make mistakes, and then others can correct us. So we're going to have another ism scorecard. We've already said boo to foundationalism, or I have. Now we want to take individualism, and I want to say boo to it, too. We want to have, if you like, collectivism. Now, where do we go from here? One of my favorite slides. On the left, we see a termite colony. On the right, we see Gaudi's famous La Sagrada Familia in Barcelona, stunningly similar structures. Two artifacts made by animals, but profoundly different in how they are made. Termites are pretty clueless. They don't know what they're doing. They just run around doing what they do, and these amazing structures emerge. Gaudi, on the other hand, was your prime example of the imperious genius, top down. He had written manifestos and everything planned out in advance, and bossing the bosses who bossed the bosses who bossed the bosses. It was a classic case of top down creativity. So now here's a puzzle. Bottom up design, a la termites, versus top down design. Alain Gaudi. A termite colony might be 70 million clueless termites. A brain might be 86 billion clueless neurons. I love this little bit of video showing neurons are active little buggers. They're not just. And I was wrong about that for years. I had a very simplistic view of neurons there. They're agents, and there are no two alike, and they have agendas. And they move around and change their positions and adjust their connections, and they're agents with agendas. And they form into things, if not committees, then into coalitions. How do you get a Gaudi-type mind out of a termite colony brain? So remember, what I'm saying is brains are, in an important regard, like termite colonies. They're made up of all these little mindless units that are themselves agents of sorts, but not very smart. Don't know much, don't care. They're very limited horizons. But if you put them together in the right way, you get a mind that can think about astrophysics and biology and poetry and all the other things. How is that possible? And the short answer is this. You can't do much carpentry with your bare hands, and you can't do much thinking with your bare brain. A termite colony is a bare brain. Doesn't have any thinking tools to speak of. A bear's brain is also a bare brain. Doesn't have any thinking tools either. But intelligent designers like us, like everybody in this room, have well-equipped brains. Brains filled with tools. Not carpentry tools, but thinking tools. Where did they get their tools? When did they get their tools? Very recently. This is my favorite picture of the tree of life. The present is here, all the way around the outside. Everything that's alive today is right out here on this boundary. This is the origin of life right here. This is the eukaryotic revolution. And way over here, you see that little Y right there? One of those branches, about 6 million years long, that's the hominid branch where we split with the chimpanzees. And it's only on that one branch in that whole tree, and only in the last few years, few hundred thousand years, that it has been capable of being tool-using, thinking tool-using organisms. So, if they got their tools very recently, and only in one species, how did they get their tools? And here's the wrong answer. Technology is a gift of God. After the gift of life, it is perhaps the greatest of God's gifts. It is the mother of civilizations, of arts, and of sciences. I think everything in that quote is true except for the first sentence. The long answer is that cultural evolution, not genetic evolution, but cultural evolution is the key. Cultural evolution designed thinking tools that impose novel structures on our brains. There are evolved virtual machines, that is to say, evolved informational entities, like algorithms, that have evolved by cultural evolution that we install in our necktops and that give us the powers we have. A computer without any apps is not very useful, but if you pile the apps in, there's all manner of things you can do with them. And what we have to understand is that in one species, Homo sapiens sapiens, we have managed to acquire thousands and thousands and thousands of thinking tools, words, methods, facts, arithmetic, mathematics, thermometers, microscopes, all the rest of it. And that's where our power comes from. the apps that we download to our necktops. That's the source of our power and versatility. You don't have to understand an algorithm to use it and benefit from it. Good thing, because most of the algorithms that we use every day, for instance, to generate the sentences that we end up speaking in our native languages with a grammatical versatility and accuracy, we don't understand the algorithms that generate those, and we don't have to. So the key is language. Not Fodor's language of thought, but ordinary human natural language. Or more generally, culture, which is evolved by its own process of natural selection of what Dawkins calls memes, which have their own fitness. Many of the most important thing to know about memes, and a point that is still remarkably resisted by many people who write about cultural evolution, is they don't recognize that memes, like viruses, have their own fitness. They evolve because they can evolve. And some of them are very good for us, and some of them are very bad for us. And we mustn't assume that everything that we acquire in the way of culture is an adaptation that serves our genetic interests. No, many of them don't. It's a price we pay for having all the memes that we salt away in our brains is that we run the risk of putting a lot of really detrimental, toxic memes in our heads. Now, just how this happens is work in progress. I've tried to give a good account of it in my book, From Bacteria to Bach and Back, and I'm still working on it hard. So now, language is the key to cumulative cultural invention, evolution. Oh my gosh, I'm running out of time. Chimpanzees, elephants, dolphins, parrots, corvids, pick your favorite smart animals, they have some items of culture that enhance their powers. A good account of that is in the book by Avital and Jablonka called Animal Traditions. Shows that a lot of what have heretofore been regarded as genetically transmitted instincts aren't in fact genetically transmitted. They're culturally, they're perceptually transmitted, they're culturally transmitted. But they can't ask questions, they can't explain, they can't teach about absent things. It's all summed up in this cartoon. Or in this cartoon, donning his new canine decoder, Professor Schwartzman becomes the first human being on Earth to hear what barking dogs are actually saying. Hey, 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 hey. Well, you may think this is a bad thing, but in fact it's important that although dogs can communicate, they can't communicate the way we can because they can't say much more than various flavors of hey, 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 hey. That's a brilliant Larson cartoon. And here's an older one which haunted me for years and I lost it and then I found it just for this talk. They keep thinking it's Tuesday. Now what's brilliant, this ran in Punch in 1937. And what's brilliant about it is he doesn't show the mouths. Clearly they're talking to each other. They've got language. But if you don't have language, this is not a thought you can have. It's hard to keep in mind how huge the gulf is between animal minds and ours. So wildebeests, shoulder to shoulder in a herd, they share a lot, but they can't share their knowledge the way we can, thanks to language. No chimpanzee knows it's a mammal in Africa, knows about icebergs or numbers of smartphones, but I know four-year-olds that do. No efforts to teach apes language have achieved liftoff. Some of you may want to challenge that, but I'm ready to defend that, say that all the ado about various attempts is overrated, and that No non-human animal has ever really ignited on language. Not that it would be impossible, but just hasn't happened. I want to draw your attention to a point about what we might call psychological shorthand, or what I call the intentional stance. We use it all the time in computer science and cognitive science. Famous article, "What the Frog's Eye Tells the Frog's Brain." Motor neurons command muscle fiber contractions. Bacteria engage in quorum sensing. But let's just look at computers. They have instructions retrieved from memory and obeyed by the instruction register. This is all somewhat metaphorical, but very useful, very useful, very good way of making sense of these things. And what these are examples are is competence without comprehension. My bumper sticker now. Competence without comprehension. Something that Turing, I think, was the real first clearly good theorist of. The fact that bacteria only sort of sense and the frog's eye only sort of tells is a feature, not a bug. These aren't real instructions, commands, memories, because they don't involve comprehension. Good thing, because they're the building blocks out of which comprehension can be composed. We need to have non-comprehending parts, the interaction of which generates more and more comprehension. That's the only way out of an infinite regress. So we have to have one more ism scorecard. But this time, I'm going to give it a check mark, gradualism. We need that. We swim in an ocean of shared facts. Tell me if any of this is news to you. Stones don't float. Icebergs float. Muffins can't talk. Trees can't see. Birds have no use for money. The Earth is a sphere orbiting around the sun. Everybody knows those, and many more things. Well, there are interesting exceptions. Spaghetti doesn't grow on trees. But some of you may know about the great Richard Dimbleby stunt of many years ago. Richard Dimbleby was the Walter Cronkite of the BBC, the man who intoned the coronation of the Queen and other things like that. And one April Fool's Day, he and his team did an elaborate stunt where they went to Italy for the annual spaghetti harvest. And they had hung spaghetti in trees, and they had peasants in native costumes on ladders with scissors cutting the spaghetti out of the trees. And they did this completely deadpan on the BBC. And so many people believed it that travel agents in England were just besieged the next day with people who wanted to get on the next plane to Italy to participate in the spaghetti harvest. So I bring this to your attention because I don't think the BBC would do this today. And for very good reason. We've had a pollution of the epistemological environment that's very dangerous. And it isn't funny anymore what you can do if you're the BBC when people are so gullible. I want to go back to David Deutsch very briefly. David has a wonderful TED Talk, which I'm recommending to you now. It has a terrible title, The Great Monotony, but you'll find it easily on the web, and I heartily encourage you all to watch it. I obliged Sean and Janan to watch it with me today at lunch because I wanted them to see what was so interesting about it. Now, Deutsch draws our attention to many facts that had never occurred to me. It's not that I couldn't have figured them out, but I just didn't. But he drew my attention to them and thought, oh, wow, yeah, I see how that goes together. Isn't that cool? Well, now, should I trust David Deutsch? Does he know these things? He's a big-time physicist, mathematician, computer scientist. Maybe not all of them, but he knows most of them. And he knows them because we know them. He is helping himself to the fruits of hundreds of years of human investigation. Communication here among us human beings is not always cooperative. Sometimes it is competitive, and that's a good thing. Let's consider Fermat's last theorem. No three positive integers, a, b, c, satisfy the equation a to the n plus b to the n plus c to the n for any integer value of n greater than 2. Now, we know that there are cases for 2 because the 3, 4, 5 right triangle is a case in point. 3 squared plus 4 squared equals 5 squared. And there's 5, 12, 13, and others. But Fermat's last theorem is that not for any exponent higher than 2. And mathematicians have been trying for hundreds of years to solve this. And in 1995, Andrew Wiles proved Fermat's last theorem. Now, if you're a lone wolf mathematician and think you've proved Fermat's last theorem, you have to consider the disjunction: either I have proved Fermat's last theorem, or I am going mad. And you have to take that seriously, because many brilliant mathematicians have gone mad and have thought they proved it when they hadn't. So how does Wiles secure security, trust in his own proof? Only the formal concession and subsequent congratulation of his competitors, his colleagues, could or should put his anxiety to rest. I don't trust Andrew Wiles. I trust the mathematical community, which vouches for him. Why do I trust the mathematical community? Because arithmetic works. We know it, every one of us. Your bank account, your wallet, you're counting the eggs in the... Arithmetic works, and we know that as an empirical fact. And if we didn't, no amount of proofs by mathematicians of the value of arithmetic, I think, would have much sway with us. I think our trust in arithmetic really depends on the empirical fact that it never leads us astray. Now, it may lead us astray. We might well destroy ourselves with the fruits of our arithmetic. We're mammals with mathematics. We're mammals with arithmetic, which is an amazing thing to be. But we shouldn't suppose that that's flawless. Ooh, I say my time is up. I've still got a bit more. I'm going to keep going a little bit. I want to talk briefly about cognitive closure. Noam Chomsky and Colin McGinn are notorious for having an argument that runs as follows. Spiders don't understand fishing, birds don't understand democracy, and surely we Homo sapiens have brains that can't fathom all topics. It just seems to be biological sense. We're not superhuman. We got brains just like birds and spiders. The big difference is that the animals don't understand the questions. If we can understand the questions, can't we understand the answers? David Wolpert, lovely mathematician out at the Santa Fe Institute, recently published just a month ago, a piece in Eon called A Sliver of Reality, or 10 Questions About the Hard Limits of Human Intelligence. And if I had much more time, I would spend a little more time on it. But I'm just saying, go read it. David Wolpert, A Sliver of Reality in Eon, see what you make of it. Here's what he says: from the perspective of my 10 queries, human exceptionalism becomes very shady. Well, I've just given you a good dose of human exceptionalism. He says, our understanding of reality is nothing more than a large set of finite string sequences, each containing elements from a finite set of possible symbols. That's true. And he goes on to say, I marvel at the limits of human language. I want to push back against that marveling with a little intuition pump of my own. The Library of Babel. How many of you read Lem's wonderful, Borges's wonderful story, The Library of Babel? You have, it's required reading basically for all my students. It's a library which contains, one figures out eventually, all possible books of 500 pages. So you have, what have I written here? There's 100 to the millionth power books. That's a finite number, but it's very large. In fact, I have a word for it. I call it vast with a capital V, which means very much more than astronomical. And vanishing is the reciprocal. It's like infinitesimal. It's not infinitesimal, but it's vanishingly small in comparison to the set you're comparing it with. So now I want to look at the Library of Babel, which is all the possible books. So here's the Library of Babel, all the possible books, and a vanishing subset, a vast but vanishing subset of those books are composed of English words. The vast majority of them are just letter salad. A vast but vanishing subset of those are grammatical. A vast but vanishing subset of those make sense. Think of all the books that are in there where you simply go to some book in the Library of Congress, pick a sentence at random and print it, then go to another book, print a sentence and pick a sentence and print it. They're all grammatical sentences, but it doesn't make any sense. A vast but vanishing subset of the books that make sense are about somebody named John. A vast but vanishing subset of those are about the death of JFK. A vast but vanishing subset of those are true. And a vast but vanishing subset of the true books about the death of JFK are composed entirely of limericks. There are more such books than there are books in the Library of Congress. The number, a finite number, can be very, very large. Among the books that you find, there are translations of all the Chinese and Arabic books, because you don't have those symbols, but the good translations and bad translations by the gazillions of all of those books are in there. Books of more than 500 pages are there in multiple volumes. There's the most accurate biography of you from the moment of your birth until your death. And gazillions of biographies of you that are accurate up till some point, like tomorrow, when they suddenly put you on a spaceship to Mars or something. There's the best argument for the existence of God is there, and the best refutation of the best argument for the existence of God is there. There are thousands of books that recount in different terms the dream you're going to have on the eve of your 30th birthday. Some of them true, many of them false. This is an immense number of opportunities to be right or wrong. Distinct opportunities. Now, do Chomsky and McGinn have an argument that shows that there's no series of 500-page books that will lead to a good, understandable answer to any question we can understand? They haven't offered one. The reason I call this ironic is that Chomsky is famous for lauding the amazing capacity of human beings to understand a vast number of sentences in their native tongue. It's just part of knowing a language. So presumably these books are all, or at least many of them, are readily understandable and there could be a sequence of books that leads you on and on and on. Or does Wolpert have an argument to show that the possibility of things, facts, models, structures, theories, incomprehensible to us, might be comprehended by other intelligences? I don't think so. So although I grant Wolpert that in principle, there could be unimaginable truths that we'll never understand. Yeah, but that doesn't mean as much as I think he thinks it means. And the reason is very simple, and it's a line that either I made up or Doug Hofstadter made up, and we can't decide who. I think he did, and he thinks I did, so we did. Anything you can do, I can do, meta. Now, I realize the young people in this room probably never heard that song, anything you can do, I can do better. But us olders, we know that song, anything you can do, I can do, meta. And it's true. And it is the key to my optimism about why, how, and when we can trust our own brains. So here are the take-home messages. Since there's no Cartesian theater, replace the hard problem with the hard question, then what happens? Our knowledge depends on competitive and collaborative activity of agent-like structures in our brains. Those are the homunculi, the neurons and larger assemblies that have agendas. And on the competitive collaborative activities of our fellow investigators, other human beings. And language is the key innovation. It permits us to go meta indefinitely, which is what I've been doing, of course, for the last hour and 8 minutes, going meta. Thanks for your attention.
Thanks very much, Dan. That was exactly what we were hoping for our first inaugural distinguished lecture. We will be having questions from the audience. We're going to do it in a funny way to make it easy for the recording. I'm going to call on people. You're going to ask a question, then I'm going to repeat it. So we're not going to have to run the microphone to you. So think of questions. While I do that, while you think of that, there's two things I wanted to say during the intro, but I got too excited, so I forgot to say, which are thanks. One person I want to thank is Bill Miller, who is right here, who through very generous donations to both the physics and philosophy departments here at Hopkins has helped make this possible. And I learned today that another thing that Bill has done is make something called the Miller Fellows at the Santa Fe Institute possible. And the very first Miller Fellow ever was Daniel Dennett. Completely coincidental right there. It's a small world. So thank you, Bill. And also thanks to Annie Zhang, who is recording us today, and the heroic team that she is part of from the film department, who swept in here at the last minute with rather hectic pleas from us to make sure that this is going to be recorded for posterity and will be on YouTube next week. So thank you, Annie, and everyone else. We do have time for questions. What's the first question? So the question is, are you just merely making an argument for greater study of natural language semantics, where we understand better how natural languages work?
No. It's a good question. We've come a long way in the study of language since Chomsky got us going with syntactic structures. And I am one who is both been enamored at times with his work and the work of the other Chomskyans, and then deeply, deeply suspicious of a lot of it. And I've come around to think that Noam got a lot of it, put us on some wrong tracks, and there's better ways of doing things. I've mentioned a few things for you to watch or see. I'm going to mention a book that I highly recommend, which somehow fell deadborn from the press, And that's a book by an Israeli linguist named Daniel Dorr, and it's called The Instruction of Imagination. And it's a knowledgeable critique of the Chomsky worldview about language, and has some very interesting suggestions of how to think about language in other ways. So that's one place I would look. I know that right now, with Chat GPT and GPT-3, there's a lot of talk about how this all disproves the Chomskyan vision altogether. And I have some sympathy for that position, but that's a long story, and I want to talk about that soon, but not today, not now.
Bill, did you have a question? The question is, two famous philosophers, William James and C.S. Peirce. C.S. Peirce's only academic affiliation ever was with Johns Hopkins University back in the day. And the question is, roughly speaking, you'll get it better than I did, Dan, but how do your views differ or engage with their views?
That's a wonderful question. And I do consider myself in the pragmatist tradition, and so there's a great deal of commonality. I've never actually set myself the task of titrating out what I agree with and what I don't agree with in James and Peirce. But that's a task well worth doing, and I haven't done it. But I think James made one huge mistake about free will, which I've discussed at some length in my book, Freedom Evolves. But it's not that big a mistake. It's wrong, but it's but I did. That's the one place where I really tackled James.
I don't know if there's any philosophy students in the audience. That sounds like it could be a good paper topic, right? All right. Full employment. Let's see. You had a question there? Sorry? No? Yeah. So the question is, a lot of the talk was focused on disagreeing with the Cartesian idea that there is a little homunculus inside our brain, but nevertheless, there are little somethings inside our brain, and at one point you referred to neurons as agents. So how does that sneak in, and where does it become agent?
Yeah. And the answer is, this was my big mistake when I said it was no progress to replace the little man with a committee. And now I say, no, it is progress to replace the little man with a committee. And why? Because the committee is not composed of smarty pants Cartesian agents, but of termite-like agents. Termites are agents of sort. They have a very limited purview. They have a very limited event horizon. They don't have many aspirations. And at the same time, we can look at a termite and think of it as just a machine. But it's a machine that's an agent of a sort. And again, this is where the gradualism comes in. We have bacteria. They're agents. So are viruses. COVID is an agent, and a very persistent one. What we have to do is keep the intentional language, treat things as agents, the way we treat our computers as agents. So after all, when you give instructions to the instruction register, you're instructing that little agent to do something. It's a harmless sort of minimal agency, and that's what we have to. Those are the parts, the ingredients out of which we can make a thinking human being.
What is the definition of the word agent that includes a virus as an agent?
It is something that has a capacity to extract information from the world and use it to further its own existence.
Okay. I thought you were going to say it's goals, and I was going to question you about goals. But yeah, its existence is perfectly valid. All right. More questions? Yes. So the question is, when we talk about termites analogously to neurons, the existence of termites as physically embodied things matters. And when we think about the neurons for their own sake, correct me if I'm getting your question wrong, what kind of domain jumping is involved in that, in leveraging that analogy, I guess?
First of all, I want to raise a red flag about your use of the word epiphenomenon. I would love it if we could go back to the original meaning of the word epiphenomenon, which is something which is not functional but perfectly causal. So when neurons respond to other neurons, there's causation between them. There's patterns, there's real patterns in the activities between those causal entities that can be given an intentional informational interpretation. This is what licenses us to say, these cells, the cone cells in your eyes are telling the brain about the wavelength of the light that's falling on them. Telling? Really? In what language? In order to solve the mind-body problem, I think we have to maybe steel ourselves to get used to gradualism and get used to thinking there's communication without comprehension, there's telling without meaning, in one sense of meaning. And all of these, thanks to computers, thanks to Turing, we now are getting our heads around the tremendous panoply of physical, causal structures that have the competence to extract information and put it to good use. But remember the squirrel on the tree. We want to make sure that we don't, the information can be there, but now the thing is something has to be able to extract that and put it to some good use, like the way the squirrel does and the way the tree typically can't. But we have to understand that that comprehension is not some light that goes on. It's the global competence of a system to deal with the information in the world around it.
More questions? I'm looking for the back. I don't want to ignore the back. Yes. So the question is, you talked about human exceptionalism and gave some arguments, you mentioned arguments for and against. And so why is that an interesting theme around which to focus our thinking?
One reason, I think, is, I'll stand up so that you so you can see me better, in case that matters. One of the habits that we have, it's a very seductive habit, and I think it's a bad one, is we attribute much more comprehension to animals, non-human animals, than they actually have. And this is part of the inflation of understanding that we grow up with. And we then inflate it further with human exceptionalism. And we have to understand that all comprehension is partial, There's no such thing as perfect comprehension. There's every imaginable grade of competence with, you want to call that comprehension? Yeah, it's a kind of comprehension up to a point. Because after all, we're going to take those semi-comprehending competences and show how they can be built up into the kind of comprehension that you and I recognize and admire in our favorite thinkers, the poets, the mathematicians, the physicists, etc.
I hope you were going to add the physicist there. Thank you, Dan. All right, more questions? Yes, this seems like a great question that I'm going to try to boil down for the recording purposes. No, I love it. And so I'll rephrase it and you tell me if I'm right. You talked about two different examples, among others, of emergence of a higher level entity from smaller, lower level things. And one vivid example is a community of people using language. And another example is a bunch of neurons in the brain. But the way in which information is bouncing around between the small scale pieces in those two examples seems importantly different in the sense that the language is something we want to attach semantic meaning to, whereas the axons firing and the dendrites and so forth in the brain is just sort of bits and bytes in a less semantic way. Is that close enough? The brain is operating as a causal system, not as a semantic system.
Thank you. One thing that I really am not persuaded by in what you say is that a semantic system is not a causal system. Well, I have a struggle trying to understand what you can mean by that, because to me, when we talk to each other, when I tell you, look out, there's a tiger to your left, I am causing you to look to your left to see the tiger because you understand the semantics of the sentence. If you don't speak English, I'm not going to get anywhere. You have to know the language. Then, if you know the language, then, of course, we cause things in each other's brains all the time. That's what we're doing here. And I think that your definition of causal, therefore, is puzzling to me, because I want to say persuasion, informing, threatening, promising, all the speech acts, they're semantic. You have to know the language in order for them to work. But when two speakers know the language, then they communicate, and that's causal as all get out. And it's different cause. If I try to do the same thing with somebody who doesn't speak any English and I don't speak any, say, Turkish, I'm not going to get very far. Now, but the behind all that, and setting that aside, there's an issue raised, which is, I think, just the right issue. And that is, how do we get from brain structures that have information in them that's utilized in controlling a body moving through its world to an entity that can talk about what it's conscious of? And that's something that I really am working on. I call that the hard question. How does the machinery work? And it's got to be machinery to get to what you're calling the semantics. And my sketchy theory is that all the time, right now, in every waking hour, probably when you're asleep as well, your brain, and this is an idea I sort of borrow from my colleague Ray Jackendoff. There's mechanisms, pretty stupid, that are generating what I call blurts. They're not speech acts, but they are candidate languagings of content in the brain. And that right now, as I'm speaking to you, my brain is generating blurts, some of which I am cherry picking and revising and thinking pretty carefully about how I put it. Other times I just blurted it out, good enough for government work. And it is this process of the mechanical, ultimately mechanical, generation of candidates for becoming speech acts, or candidates for becoming just words in a sentence, that are then in a continuous generate and test round of cherry picking, eventually yield the things that we tell each other. And are we authoritative about them? In one sense, yes, as Rorty claimed. Not because we have papal authority or because we have perfect introspective access to what we mean, but just because we're in a better position to know what we're trying to get at than anybody else is. That's why we ask each other, what do you think of this? We wouldn't bother asking if we didn't want to grant that sort of authority. But it's provisional and defeasible. I don't know if that goes any way to answering, but that's the question I'm working on. Okay, well, I made some progress, I guess.
This might be a bigger issue that we should talk about. Thank you. I know there's lots of questions left. It's getting late. I'm just gonna ask for one more question.
Yeah.
The audience is concerned that there has been backsliding, in part because we're talking about both perceptions and language, but that linguistic representation of our perceptions necessarily involves some degree of coarse graining. We don't have the richness of verbal expression that we would have, or linguistic expression that we have for what we see in the world. Does this give us some insurmountable problem?
I don't think it's insurmountable, but I think it's very difficult. And I think what I agree with in what you say is that it's a big mistake to think that here's how language works. We're conscious of color qualia, and we recognize them, and we know the names of them, and we say them, there's no real issue about how we get from the richness of our conscious experience to the language we can use to talk about it. We can't capture all the richness in our experience with language. Language is, for all its wonders, not a powerful enough expressive tool. But we can get close. At times I've talked about this and said it's we resort to metaphors. We resort to using the things in the world that we're conscious of to stand for the things that we say are going on in our head. And we count on people, you know what a giraffe is, and I know what a giraffe is. And what I'm thinking about right now is sort of like a giraffe. But it isn't a giraffe. And, it's not a good example. But again, it's this hard question that I'm trying to deal with. How do you make the transition from the states of the subpersonal states in the brain, which are ultimately doing all the work? That's where the causation happens. How do you get from the subpersonal states to the first person point of view? And I think the answer to that is, strangely enough, thanks to the second person point of view. The consciousness is a user illusion. It's a very valuable user illusion. Whose user illusion is it? Is my consciousness my user illusion? Yes, but it's also yours. If you want to know about my consciousness, you ask me and I can tell you. And part of what I can tell you about, I couldn't tell you about. Part of what I can tell you about relies on, exploits our mutual understanding of the same language. And this is a process that has developed from childhood, and it's got many curious features. That's where Daniel Doerr's book, The Instruction of Imagination, I find very useful, which I have recommended to you. Well, I can't think of any short, efficient way of going on from that.
I want to note that as experimental evidence for what Dan has been saying, this would not have been an interesting lecture if there had been no audience members. We needed that plurality to make it happen. So I wanted to appreciate all of you for coming, and let's all thank Dan for a wonderful talk.
Thank you.